different materials have different thermal properties, and one of those properties is specific heat capacity. That's the energy required to raise the temperature of 1 kilogram of a substance by 1 degree Celsius. Now, actually, that's encapsulated in this equation here. The change in thermal energy is equal to mass times specific heat capacity times temperature change. In this case, it doesn't matter whether you use degrees or kelvins, because we're just interested in a difference in 2 points, a difference in temperature. There are two methods that you need to know to measure the specific heat capacity of a substance. The first is an electrical heater method. You basically are going to plot a graph of energy on the y-axis and mass times temperature change on the x-axis, so you get specific heat capacity as the gradient of the graph. Now, that uses the idea that the electrical energy is supplied, which is VIT, potential difference times current times time, power times time, is equal to the change in thermal energy. There's another method, which is called the method of mixture. Essentially, what you do with this is you raise a mass of metal, a metal block, to 100 degrees Celsius by leaving it submerged in some boiling water. So it's going to reach thermal equilibrium with the boiling water. Then you submerge that block in some cool water, and you have measured the mass and the starting temperature of that water, and you measure the temperature change of the water. You measure the final temperature, and you work out the temperature change. And you also therefore measure the temperature decrease of the metal. You then use the equation below to calculate the specific heat capacity of the metal. So the energy change for the metal once it's submerged in the water is this left-hand side, and the energy change for the water once the metal's submerged and they've reached thermal equilibrium again is on the right-hand side. And you use the value of specific heat capacity of water, which is known as 4,200 joules per kilogram per degree Celsius. Now, it's a really difficult one to eliminate systematic error in either of these two practicals, and that's because there's always going to be thermal energy transferred between the block and their surroundings. In this case, they're normally hotter than the surroundings, so you're actually losing energy, you're actually heating the surroundings as well as heating the block. And for this reason, you normally get with these two experiments a slightly higher specific heat capacity than you're expecting. Another thermal property of materials is specific latent heat. There's two specific latent heats. One is for fusion, and that is energy required per kilogram for a change of phase between a solid and a liquid, and specific latent heat of vaporization, which is the energy required per kilogram for a change of phase between a liquid and a gas. Now, it doesn't matter whether we're going between a gas and a liquid or a liquid and a gas, it doesn't matter which direction it is, the energy change is the same. It's just whether energy is going in or energy is coming out. So for example, in fusion, when a substance melts, its internal energy is increased by the same value as it will decrease when it freezes. The equation for energy for a change in phase is E equals ML, so mass times specific latent heat. Now, my pro tip here for this and the previous equation is that actually the units of specific latent heat and the units of specific heat capacity can tell you exactly what they mean. And that's a really important idea in physics, the idea that the units tell us the dimensions that tell us really what the definition of that quantity is. You need to know a method for measuring latent heat of a material, and that's an electrical heater method. You need to know a method to measure the latent heat of fusion and of vaporization of water or any other material, really. You can use an electrical heater to melt some crushed ice. You're going to measure the potential difference, the current and the time, and the mass of water collected under a funnel. And if you plot a graph of energy on the y-axis versus mass of crushed ice on the x-axis, you get a gradient, which is the specific latent heat. This is the idea that the electrical energy, VIT, is equal to mass times specific latent heat. To measure the specific latent heat of vaporization, then you need to actually boil some water and collect the vapor that's made. So you actually need to recondense that vapor and then collect that and measure the mass of the recondensed vapor. So you're measuring the mass of water, but that's the water that's been boiled, if that makes sense. As with the last experiment, you need to consider the energy transfer between the room and the substance you're investigating. And this again is going to lead to a systematic error in your result. Now, this is likely going to be a little bit too small in the method for fusion, as the ice is going to gain energy from the room. The room's going to transfer energy to the ice. And it's going to be a bit too large in the method for vaporization, as the hot water will transfer energy to the room. And another pro tip with these experiments is that temperature doesn't change during a change of phase, so we need to make sure our ice is already melting before we're beginning to measure the energy. If you pull ice straight out of the freezer, it'll likely be somewhere like minus 20 degrees Celsius, and you actually want to know that it's at zero when you start the experiment. So you crush it and let it begin to melt, dripping off any excess water before you start the practical. In the same reason, we wouldn't start measuring the energy when we were boiling the water before we reached boiling point, because we're only interested in the energy supplied during the change of phase, not during the heating, not during the gain of temperature.